children who were sacrificed on the mountain about 500 years ago. Since then, the mummies have been lying buried beneath the ice. But these mummies aren't just remarkable for the state in which they were found, they were also discovered in a remarkable way. At one point, a team member had to be lowered into a 2-meter excavation held only by his ankles so he could remove one of the mummies. Three bodies have now been taken from the mountaintop to the nearby town of Salta, Argentina, where scientists are busy running tests on these very well-preserved remains.
For more now, Dr. Jane Pratt joins me from Washington, D.C. She's the president of the Mountain Institute, the organization that sent one of its archaeologists to head up the expedition. Dr. Pratt's been in contact with him ever since the discovery just days ago. Hello, Dr. Pratt.
Good evening, Jill.
So, can you describe these mummies as they've been described to you?
Well, yes. They're three children, two girls and a boy, and they appear to be between 9 and 12 years old, say. What makes them particularly unusual is that they appear to be perfectly preserved, and their bodies have been frozen since burial.
And that's because they were buried quite deep?
Well, they were buried evidently at about 6 feet deep, which is quite an unusual depth for a mummy find.
So it sounds like there's a few unusual things about this. What do we know about, I guess, the sacrifice that they were part of and how they died and why they would have been mummified?
Well, the Inca are known to have made human sacrifices. In their culture, they worship both the sun, but they also worship the mountain as a god, not as the abode or the home of gods, but very often believing the mountain itself was a god. And we know that the Inca made sacrifices to propitiate the god. We think also that they may have made sacrifices as a kind of exchange for things that they took from the mountain, so that it was maybe what an economist would say, placing a very high marginal cost on the value of resources extracted from the mountain.
Do we know how they might have been mummified?
Well, they're mummified simply by being frozen. We don't know in this case how they died exactly.
We don't know about the ritual sacrifice itself?
Well, we know that with the first frozen mummy that was found on the Mountain Institute expedition on Mount Ampato in Peru in 1995, we have a good deal of information about that sacrifice, and we know from the CAT scans that were done that child was killed by a blow to her head. They've just completed CAT scans on the Argentinian mummies, and there's no evidence that these children were killed by any kind of blow. In fact, there seems not to be much of a mark on them, except for one child who was later, her face was damaged by a lightning strike many years later.
How did you know it was damaged by lightning?
Well, this is the world's highest archaeological site, Jill. It's at 22,000 feet, and it's a place that is perpetually stormy. The archaeologist, led by Dr. Johann Reinhardt, the Mountain Institute senior fellow, really had to battle 70-mile-an-hour winds throughout this entire dig. And Joe Reinhardt told me on the phone that they had some pretty spectacular storms up there while they were excavating.
Now, we want to hear more about that adventure in just a moment, but before that, you mentioned that one was sort of struck by lightning. I've read also that one of the children had a peculiar shape to their head, sort of a cone-shaped head.
Right.
Can you tell us more about that?
Well, that's a practice that was common throughout the Andes, and what they would do is place a kind of paddleboard on the children's head and strap it from the time that they were infants, really, to help shape their heads into shapes that were we look at now and we say, well, those are very reminiscent of nearby mountains. They did the same, they had a practice also where the different local people would have different kinds of hats, and the hats would be smooth on, round on top or peaked on top, depending on the shape of the local mountain. So we think that's maybe what they were doing with shaping the children's heads.
So it's obviously during their life, not just as part of
infancy, right.
Wow. And Dr. Pratt, how much better preserved are these mummies than previous finds, even as impressive as Juanita was?
Well, these three children, Juanita, of course, was frozen, and that was the first time a frozen mummy had been found. But in this case, the doctor who did the CAT scan said that even the internal organs appear to be perfectly preserved, the kidneys and so forth. And he is quite confident he even detected frozen blood in the aorta of one child. When I talked to Joe Reinhardt on the phone, he said it was just incredible. The one part of an arm that was exposed, he said you could even see the fine hairs on the arm. It was like they had just died yesterday and been frozen.
That's going to make for some exciting research to come.
Absolutely, and they'll be able to detect nuclear DNA for the first time.
Wow. Can you quickly tell us, just before we let you go, about some more of Dr. Reinhardt's sort of adventure, I guess, uncovering these? You mentioned the high winds and the storms.
He had been up to this site twice before. He had a hunch that there was something up there, and it was only when he took his climbing team, mostly from Peru, up with him that they were able to camp up at 22,000 feet long enough to be able to dig down 6 feet. One of the team members almost died from pulmonary edema, which is a condition that attacks climbers at high altitudes, but they were able to get him back down safely at the end, and he's all right now. But we do have more information about it on the Mountain Institute's website at www.mountain.org for people who'd like to hear more.
Great. Well, thank you very much for telling us this much about it, Dr. Pratt. Good to talk to you.
Good to talk to you too, Jill.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Dr. Jane Pratt is the president of the Mountain Institute. She spoke to me tonight from Washington, D.C.
They brought our four horses forward, and I'm over getting my direction from a little Moroccan military man who spoke no French at all, and I kept trying to, you know, ask him little tips and little pointers as to how I would manage this beast. And he kept making motions like this horse liked to go fast, and this horse was going to move quickly, and that the only way to stop it was to pull very quickly back on the reins. And I thought, well, I mean, I've ridden a little bit, so I'm sure I can handle this. And he sort of boosted me up, and the second my weight hit the saddle, it was gone on a full gallop. This is probably going to be one of those moments that I'm just going to have to face. And I figured if I just bent forward and hung on to the mane, I'd be fine. And I just sort of closed my eyes. And I mean, it was a beautiful feeling. You were just moving with the horse. And I stayed on, and I stayed alive. And it was absolutely exhilarating to experience that.
Your email. Vancouver? Genius. Pass it on to Epps. He's running it through the Northwest.
Hey, Matt. Ideas to hit the Northwest. I've got purchasing checking suppliers.
You want it up top. Client briefing. Your Vancouver idea.
Want to take your business to the next level? Electronic commerce. From AT&T Canada.
Friday on Discovery Channel. Travel to a land of fairy tales, a land of mystic beauty, guarded by treacherous canyon walls, a place where only the most tenacious of creatures survive. In defiance of gravity and common sense, Canadian Geographic presents Life on the Vertical, The Goats of Stikine Canyon, on Discovery's Canada, Friday on Discovery Channel.
take on the competition.